Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me and having me here. So far, it has been a very nice event, which I enjoyed. I'm coming to tell you a little bit about cloud applications in the real world, in my field of experience in e-health. I mean, this has a little bit of a history, because we have seen the National Program for IT, which could not deliver what it has promised so far. We have seen a couple of new ideas, pathways, that are moving more and more and increasingly in the direction of cloud in healthcare. And if I look at not only on a national but on an international level, I see basically all of the research efforts that are going on in the moment in Europe, but also in the United States and Asia, they're moving towards the cloud. So although things might seem a little bit slow at the moment, I'm very much convinced that the cloud computing will play a huge role over the next 5 to 10 years, not only in the UK, but in particular on the Asian markets. So let me just talk to you about a couple of projects that have been associated with cloud in healthcare. I don't want to go too much into technological details. I will talk a little bit more about the application side of things. I think you've heard quite a lot already today about technology. So what I want to speak about are these different kind of platforms, and I'm sure that one or the other is well known to you. I want to talk about a little bit about Google Health, about Microsoft Health Vault, about a project, a bioserialization project that was done, has been done recently. I want to talk about a pharmaceutical project that has been done in Sweden, which goes a little bit further, about the Dakar project and Cloud for Health, the Munich platform, and EPSOS. All of these coming from different directions and contributing to healthcare or future healthcare in different ways. So the questions I try to answer, try to anticipate, and maybe we can later have a little bit of a discussion about that, is will we see cloud computing in healthcare in the UK, Europe, globally, within the next 2, 3, 5, 10 years? Will it be a public cloud? Will it be a private cloud? Will there be business opportunities for UK SMEs? And what role, in general, will distributed computing play for healthcare in the future? Google Health, I'm sure most of you know that, has been discontinued. So when Google started off, they had this huge vision of this public cloud platform that will store all patient files in the world, and everybody will be able to link everything with everything, and there will be access rights, and there will be regulations, and we can have everything on this global, on this big platform. To be honest with you, when I started working in the field 10 years ago or so, we all thought that this is the thing. This is the thing we're after. This is the quest. Some kind of public cloud, and it will come sooner and later. 5 years ago, this became rather unlikely, and I spoke actually to some people from Google a couple of years ago, and they were still pretty positive about it. But then they had to understand, and we all had to understand over the last couple of years, that the public cloud in healthcare is not flying. It's a no-go. We're not getting anywhere with that. The markets simply rejected the concept of the public cloud. So in a way, this question seems to be answered for the time being. Public cloud, no. Private cloud, yes. So Google Health has been discontinued. They took it off the market, which has been disappointing, you know, because if a giant like Google is withdrawing from such an area, that means something. Microsoft Health Vault was the natural next big competitor. So when Google came up with their ideas, Microsoft said, well, you know, we want to do something similar. We want to compete. and they created the idea of the Microsoft Health Vault. Again, the approach was pretty much the same, some kind of big cloud, public cloud setup where all the data will be stored and then the data will be exchanged, there will be services designed for different needs and all of these kind of things. Now, Microsoft has not withdrawn the concept like Google did, but Microsoft has scaled down and Microsoft is targeting a slightly different market now. We have to do with them quite a lot in one research project that we're doing in the moment. We are doing something together with them as a trusted services research project. And the target of Microsoft with the Health Vault in the moment is the informal sector rather than the formal sector. So Health Vault, Microsoft is not aiming actively in getting hospitals subscribed to their platform, but is now more aiming at people, at individuals that want to exchange information with their informal carers. Now, informal carers in this context means friends, family, social network, and the issues that are coming up at the moment in Health Vault is trust, M2M, machine to machine, human to machine, and how can we link actually the formal care, doctors, nurses, hospitals, with the informal side, social network, friends, family, which is a big and important issue for the future given the demographic development and that we're facing, not only we, but all of the Western world. Bayer, got engaged in a project with the Turkish government. So their idea about cloud technology in healthcare was all circling around medication. So prevent fraud, counterfeiting, all of these kind of things. So how can we make sure, how can you make sure that that pack of paracetamol that you hold in your hand is really manufactured where it says that it's manufactured? How can you make sure that you really have the ingredients in that pack of paracetamol that you hold in your hand? And this is a project which Bayer developed together with the Turkish government because the Turkish government had concerns about their pharmacists and about the way they trade their medication and wanted to make sure that they only pay for medication that has really been dispensed to the public. So Bayer, with the Turkish government, developed some kind of repository where actually the medication could be traced through the market in Turkey. This is a very isolated project, very focused. So the innovation potential of this is limited, but the economic means is large because we're talking products worth billions here. The EFPIA, so the European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industries and Associations, basically created a similar project, but that went a little bit further because they thought about standardization, how can they actually use this kind of repository in a wider context, in a wider Europe. So the testbed, I think, was based in Sweden, and they tried not only unidimensional barcodes, but they now tried these two-dimensional barcodes that are basically available, made available by GS1, which is a European-wide, worldwide operating organization. So EFPIA went a little bit further, and the project is still ongoing than the Bayer project. Again, there's a huge market potential involved, multi-billion value, and I think it can make a considerable contribution. The Dakar project was a project I was involved in. This was, you can see, a whole variety of partners, Imperial College London, GS1 UK, Chelsea in Westminster, Cypher Lab, Codit, and Edinburgh Napier University. And what we tried is to actually use cloud computing to bring together devices that you can find in hospital environments. In particular, there was the idea of getting things right with patient identity. Basically, if we could make patients carry RFID wristbands and we could identify them better, then we could avoid a lot of problems, a lot of errors that occur in the NHS that cause a lot of litigation, cause a lot of problems. And this was something which was funded by the Technology Strategy Board. And it was a project that ran between 2009 and 2011. The technology proved to be new and interesting. The implementation was very difficult. It was more difficult than we all thought. And I don't know if we really nailed it with the implementation, but the technology was definitely successful, and the in vitro testing was good. So we could test it in a living lab, but the transfer into the real world environment failed. I have to admit that. Cloud for Health is a project that we're doing at the moment at Napier. It goes a little bit further than Dakar. So basically, we use the Dakar technology, controlling front-end applications with the cloud, but added trust components. My colleague, Bill Buchanan, Professor Bill Buchanan, who is the head of the Center for Security at Annenberg-Napier University, he's looking into this dimension, trust, security. How can we make these concepts safe? And Bill is collaborating with Microsoft in a trusted services call that I mentioned early on, where they are looking into informal care. How can information be distributed in a social network, a network of carers, friend families, especially in the elderly? Keyword here would be ambient assisted living. The Munich platform is a research project that is going on in the moment at the Technical University in Munich, more exactly the teaching hospital of the Technical University Munich. It's called Klinikum Rechts der Isar. It's one of the biggest university hospitals in Europe. And there, a group of researchers, we contributing there as well, but also industries and SMEs, working together with the minimal invasive surgeons. And the idea behind the Munich platform is to get information from different sources across different domains, across different networks, and merge these data to create multidimensional real-time information, to create what the Internet of Things people would call content. So we are using the Internet. We are using front-end technologies like RFID, and we are using the cloud to run and monitor data streaming across different domains and across different networks to bring that all together in real time. In the moment, a couple of these front-end applications are, for example, the tagging of abdominal towels that you use for surgery to make sure that you don't forget one of these inside when you close up. So there is a system implemented based on RF technology that is checking at any point in time that the numbers of used towels and fresh towels in theater is equal, so that not one is forgotten inside the abdominal cavity. There are also attempts to tag tools, instruments, camera parts with RF tags. We are trying to merge this with information that we are retrieving in real time from the monitoring devices, from the smart devices like ECG monitors and so forth. And also, we are in the process of establishing a system where we can actually track and trace all of the materials and medication that are used during the procedure so that we get a very multidimensional and accurate picture of what is going on in theater. And if you imagine how at the moment health records are created and how procedures are documented, namely with pen and paper, and you compare that with a multidimensional picture that you can actually store, then you realize what kind of difference that makes, because you are really able to tell what kind of materials were used, and you are able to track them down. So if you find 5 years later that a certain product, be it whatever, you know, I mean, just remember the problems we had with the artificial breasts just recently here in the UK. I mean, nobody is really able to tell where these products are and how many of these products were used. People might ask themselves, do I have to be concerned? Did I receive one of these products that were affected or not? These kind of questions are very difficult to answer these days with notes that are actually just some scribbles on a piece of paper. But if you are able to monitor all of these things in some kind of database and you can access that in a multidimensional way, your accuracy is much better. Again, you can reduce risk, you can reduce litigation. So I'm not only talking about finances here, but I'm also talking about quality of care. EPSOS is a very interesting project. EPSOS is a huge European project which will end in September 2013, I think. It was worth about 40 million euro. And EPSOS is aiming on the migration of patient information across national borders in Europe. The idea behind it is if you travel to Spain on holiday and you have an accident and people have to treat you there, then there is very frequently the problem that information cannot be there in time when needed. And EPSOS is a project which will be cloud-based in order to get and bring information together, if necessary, from different countries across borders and create a data set that can then form a workable basis for the treatment abroad. As I said, it's about the budget. I looked it up just earlier on. It's 40 million. There's 47 different partners. UK is a partner in that. And the thing is that there has been done a lot of development over the last couple of years, but the proof lies in the pudding. And the proof has just started. So they just announced that they now start the test phase, which will be running over the next 12 months. So I have to be a little bit careful with what I say here, because what I told you is pretty much an accurate reflection on the aims and objectives of the project. We will have to see over the next couple of months whether EPSOS will really deliver on these kind of things. I would not be able. These acronyms are sometimes very difficult. I don't know all the acronyms by heart. But what you can do is if you go on the web, www.epsos.eu, then you get all the information for the EPSOS project. Sorry about that. Should have probably added that so that it is clearer. Okay. Now, and I have to warn you in a way. I have done something. So what I did is I tried to map somehow all of these projects. Yeah. So what I've done here is, if you want, a very subjective analysis of mine, admittingly, on the projects and where I believe that we stand. So what I tried to do is basically create this compass kind of diagram. See north, south, west, east, whereby the west, east is more or less the progression, something I would call the progression. So for me, the progression is if you basically have more of the same or something that is a little bit better, but not groundbreakingly different. And then on the south-north axis, you can see the technological evolution. So something that is really different. And I tried to map here the projects looking at the configuration. And you can see that, for example, the Bayer project I was talking about, I don't think in the context of cloud computing this was really groundbreaking new, but then again, you know, this was something which took place in 2006 and 2007, so I think this is reasonable to place it more to the west and more to the south. EPSOS is a far more dynamic project, but then again, I think it is more of the same, probably better, but in terms of cloud computing, well, we will have to see. I don't know whether there's really an evolution so far. We will have to wait and see. The projects like, I mean, Google Health, I put that at the zero point in the middle because obviously it has been discontinued. So it was a good idea, the time being, but it's not going anywhere. Health Vault is definitely better. It is still alive. It is still delivering. And one has to see where they are moving to, whether they manage to integrate the informal care. If they do so, then this will be hugely successful. This will be a fantastic project, because given the demographic development, informal care will take a huge place over the next 20 years. There's no question about that. Formal care will never be able to satisfy the needs of the aging population and to deliver. So very, very interesting project, and we definitely needs to be observed. Then, I mean, the EFPIA project is definitely different from the Bayer project, and definitely interesting in terms of cloud, because if this is really something that grows and is getting more popular, then we're talking here about a multi-billion pound, dollar, you name it, project, which will really, really play a role. And I think the ones with the biggest potential in the moment that I can oversee, I mean, I'm sure there are other projects which I don't know, maybe in the United States or maybe somewhere in Europe, but I believe that Cloud for Health and Munich has the biggest potential, because there is an attempt to bring all of these different qualities together and merge them. So we are basically thinking about creating services that are able to deliver on interoperability, standardization, different qualities of data across different domains, across different networks, physical networks. And I think this is what is needed, you know, because we have a problem in the moment with bandwidth, we have a problem in the moment with frequency, so we have to think of different physical networks. There will be new networks. The networks need to adopt somehow cloud principles in terms of load balancing and all of these kind of things. And all of this needs to happen. But the problem is that all of this needs to happen in some kind of reasonable setup. So we have a lot of projects in the moment that are evolving in some kind of living lab setup, somewhere in the lab and so on. What we really need, in my opinion, are projects that are out there in the real world environment, so that we can really see how they work and get some feedback. I have to be careful with time. I probably talked far too long. So just in a nutshell, what I want to, my ideas that I want to share with you is basically that the market has rejected the public cloud approach for healthcare records. I mean, there can be no doubt about that. I think there will be strong demand for integration and interoperability tools. I can see that already, because by the end of the day, every healthcare provider will have their own private cloud platform with their own ideas, and all of this need to be brought together somehow. So we need interoperability as a service, we need integration as a service, we need all of these kind of things, because otherwise it will not work. We need integration across the domains, mobile distributed clouds. This is something which I strongly believe will appear. Yeah? So we can see that all of our smartphones getting bigger, more powerful, more smart. What is it actually that keeps me away from having ad hoc clouds? So four people with smartphones coming together and these different kind of machines forming clouds. And when these people part, or one of these people is leaving, the cloud will go on. It will not stop. It will not break apart, but it will reconfigure, will adjust to the new requirements, and will continue to deliver. And I believe this will play a big role in the future, not only in health, but in many areas. Horizon 2020, I can't say too much about that because of time, but this is a new EU strategy. We just discussed it in Aalborg in Denmark a couple of days ago. So this is the next big thing, and what it says is basically alignment of technology and social issues. So no more technology isolated development, but everything needs to be put into perspective with real world applications. Networks are indefensibles. We have heard about that a lot. So the whole idea of these network patchworks that are growing everywhere in the NHS trusts, I don't believe in that at all, because I think that the networks will be indefensible, and we have to go completely different ways, namely encryption, definitely separated databases, not centrally stored, and all of these kind of things. And we will move to heavily distributed structures. So, hard is soft and soft is hard. Tom Peters, management guru, I think we have to focus far more on the elements that we still think are soft or not so meaningful. And I think the elements that are very, very much looked at in the moment are maybe not the ones that we really need to consider as the problem. Thank you very much.